This is the CineSnob Podcast.
Welcome to episode 184 of the CineSnob Podcast. I'm Jerrod Kingery.
And I'm Cody Viafania.
And our third member, Jocelyn, is still on maternity leave, though she did watch one of the movies you said, Cody. She watched Hubie Halloween.
Yes.
Which we'll talk about shortly. That seems like it was a penance for her, as opposed to an enjoyable time.
Yeah, well, we thought that, you know, if we had to do it and put up with it, now that she's a full-fledged member of the team, she had to, you know, she wasn't going to get away with this.
Right, yeah. And we are live on Twitch right now. Hello. We've got Larry. Larry McGillicuddy is asking, how's her baby? I guess he's fine. I mean, I don't know.
Yeah, no reports otherwise.
Yeah, I mean, she posted a photo yesterday of, like, her in 2007, like, in, like, about a Longhorns game that I guess
they,
if...
But that
if
they lost.
Yeah. I guess if things were going... weren't going well with the baby. That sounds terrible, but I don't think she'd be posting about football games. But you can use those clues to deduce what. I guess the baby's fine, is what I'm saying. He's a baby. I'm sure he's just sleeping, and you know, there's a lot of people going, "Oh, he's so adorable."
Yeah.
Maybe. So let's talk about hats real quick. The baby is a good man, Larry. Let's talk about hats real quick. Cody, you're wearing a Taking Lives hat.
Yes.
Which we determined was an Angelina Jolie, Ethan Hawke movie from the early 2000s that had a very 2000s cast with Olivier Martinez and Checky Cairo, who was like huge on ER. Did you ever watch ER?
No.
He was like the George Clooney replacement.
Oh.
And then he was in Elektra. Did you ever see Elektra?
Mm-mm. Is that the Jennifer Garner?
Yeah, it's the spinoff of Daredevil. Anyway, the hat that you wanted to wear.
Yeah.
That is not big enough that maybe we should donate to little Hugo.
Yeah, maybe.
Is a,
maybe that's a baby gift. I didn't.
That would be a perfect baby gift. It's Mr. Bean's Holiday.
Yes.
Which I believe is the second Mr. Bean movie.
Oh, I don't know.
I don't know how many there are. There are three Johnny English movies. Am I correct in that?
Man, are there?
I think there are. We need to look that up. Because I think I feel like there's two Mr. Bean movies. What those share in common is Rowan Atkinson. I feel like there's two Mr. Bean movies and three Johnny English movies.
There are three Johnny English movies. As far as Mr. Bean, the only one I see is Mr. Bean's Holiday.
Oh.
There's one just called Bean.
Oh, okay. That's right. Okay. I can't believe that Johnny English has more than Mr. Bean.
Yeah.
I feel like, but I mean, Mr. Bean has like a cartoon. I don't know anything about either of those two. I feel like Johnny English is a sort of lower rent Austin Powers. But I have no frame of reference for it whatsoever.
It's always weird hearing Rowan Atkinson just like talk normally, and he sounds like a posh British man. It's just very strange.
It's like when he does like something like minorly dramatic.
Yeah.
Like instead of mugging for a camera and like falling into a bucket of paint or something. there was something I saw him in recently that I was very surprised by. I don't remember though.
I know what you're talking about because I think if it's recent, I thought the same thing.
Let's see. Rowan Atkinson. What has he done recently? Let's look at his IMDb and then maybe I can figure it out because it's going to drive me crazy because I know it was something that really threw me off.
He played a Hitler in Peaky Blinders.
Well, I don't watch Peaky Blinders, so that wasn't it. He was in, let's see. I know he was in Love Actually, and that's probably maybe what I'm, I don't know. Mm. He's, maybe it's not, because he's only been in a few movies since, a few things since, Johnny English Strikes Again, One Red Nose in a Wedding, something called Ollie Murs featuring Snoop Dogg.
That was it, right?
That was probably it. Mr. Bean, Matt Willis, whatever. This is all British stuff, so I have no idea. Well, this went nowhere, so...
Yeah, we should probably hit the parachute on this conversation.
Yeah, Mr. Bean talk, Rowan Atkinson talk went off the rails quickly, so... Let's talk about some things that we know are happening in the news. Cody, you wanted to talk about Soul, the new Pixar film.
Yeah, so this had been speculated for some time, but Pixar's Soul, the directed by Pete Docter, is officially hitting Disney Plus on Christmas. And the big notable thing about this is that it is, unlike Mulan, which was a $29.99 rental, Soul is coming out for free on Disney Plus, which is a huge deal and probably one of the bigger movies to ever hit streaming in terms of just like replacing, box office potential success, potential box office success with something streaming. So it should be interesting. Soul seems like an interesting movie. It seems like one of those, you know, it's Pete Docter who did Inside Out. So it seems like it might be one of those more, heady movies. And to me, the most fascinating thing is that it has a Trent Reznor score on a Pixar movie, which is crazy.
It has, there's been a few reviews hitting today, from, London that call it like that are have very it's very high praise for Soul. The Deadline headline says Pixar's Soul recalls the lofty ambitions of the studio's finest. And then IndieWire says it's one of the studio's very best. I mean, early reviews always are a little rough, and I think that you and I have talked about the film festival bubble. But it's a huge deal, and I don't know that it's, I don't know that it's got any kind of buzz to it right now. I don't feel like it's something that I've seen a lot of going into it because it's been so, everything's been so up in the air.
Well, I think the other piece too is that the trailers and stuff have not, we haven't been to the movies since March. So, we would normally be bombarded with trailers going to the theater or, ads or cutouts and stuff like that. And without that, there's been nothing. So, it hasn't had a ton of buzz because I remember I saw the trailer for the first time, I think watching Onward earlier this year. It's Pete Docter, so I expect it to be an introspective movie about, contemplating life, which I read something that he was having like a bit of a midlife crisis and kind of made a movie out of it.
Is he the head of Pixar now? I forget. I believe he is.
I believe that he is, yeah.
Yeah, with John Lasseter being revealed as a total creepo.
Yeah. Yep. He hugged too many people and made very many people uncomfortable. Yeah, so he's the... Pete Docter's the CCO, which I believe is Chief Creative Officer.
Yeah. So that's going to be interesting because I think that, I don't know if it's ever been the case for you or your family before we started doing this gig, actually going to the movies on Christmas Day. I know a lot of people like to do that. And typically there's four or five movies that open on Christmas Day.
The only one that I can vividly remember going to on Christmas Day was True Grit. I saw on Christmas Day.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
But not like specifically for Christmas, or was it just that's how it happened to shake out?
This was me and some family members wanted to see a movie on Christmas, and that's what we landed on. So
how'd that go? That's a kind of a little denser Coen Brothers work.
Not my favorite Coen Brothers movie, certainly, but fine. I think it's a fine
Jeff Bridges talking like he's spitting out his gum, or spitting out his teeth the whole time.
Yeah, like you just had a peanut butter sandwich.
I think it's probably going to be the only new thing hitting anything.
Well,
on
if
Christmas
Wonder
Day.
Wonder Woman is still on the calendar, I cannot imagine it coming out on Christmas, but it is on the calendar as of right now.
I thought it got pushed. Maybe I'm thinking of something else.
I don't believe that it has been officially pushed.
Yeah. So the that also plays into our next topic here, that Regal Cinemas actually shut down this past week.
Oh, I was going to say, we might have talked about it because they were potentially going to shut down last week, but
yeah.
As of Thursday, they are closed.
Yeah, and I can't imagine that most people or most theaters won't follow suit. I was I mentioned having to go to the mall last week, I think, and passing by the AMC theater, and I did notice that the theater was closed again, but the schedule was closed on like Wednesdays and Thursdays only. So like they weren't offering any showings on Wednesdays and Thursdays, and then we're opening fairly late. So I don't know what it looks like when it's open, but there's no, there's nothing else coming out. I think The War with Grandpa is probably the only theatrical release that I noticed that was playing there.
Well, it all depends on the area, I think, because San Antonio is in such a weird place where, like of the movies that we're reviewing this week, like two of them are actually playing down the street from me. And these are tiny movies. I mean, these are movies, I think I said this last time, but even at the indie theater, they would not have ever come to the indie theater.
Right.
Like they are taking everything that's opening. And weirdly enough, too, one of the things that's happening is that Netflix and Apple TV are putting out their stuff in theaters a couple weeks early. So, like, next week is Trial of the Chicago 7 on Netflix. The week after is On the Rocks on Apple TV. Those are both out in theaters here.
Yeah.
Which, again, super weird. It's so weird right now.
Yeah, it's such a strange thing to be experiencing that these things are, you know, the whole year is kind of on hold, and basically everything that was supposed to be released this year is coming out next year. So moving forward, you know, they've talked about the Oscars before. Like, I can't even imagine holding a ceremony in 2021.
Yeah, well, just with the lack of stuff that's been released, you mean?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, because there's...
Well, the thing is, it remains to be seen what Oscar season looks like, because the stuff that's been pushed is not going to be your typical, like, Oscar fare.
Right.
So you'll still have... I mean, David Fincher has a movie coming out later this year. I'm trying to think of if there's any other big
but
ones.
But it's a Netflix movie.
Sure, but what... I mean, what
no,
is that?
Wait, so... Sure, I get it. I mean, I see what you're saying. They're going to play it. I'm getting my things crossed here, but yeah, they are going to play it in theaters, obviously. But yeah, but like Soul, if Soul doesn't hit theaters, it won't be eligible.
Well, they've changed they added drive-ins as a thing. So, that is a good point. I have to imagine it's going to come out in some capacity to be Oscar eligible. I mean, there's at this point they're going to be lenient, I think, because I mean it doesn't benefit the Oscars to be exclusionary right now,
right?
In any way, shape, or form. So you know, I could see some of those things changing, and I can see maybe you know, making an exception for streaming for this year. Like it doesn't have to, because previously it had to be day and date. Or like at best, and I think actually it had to open in theatrically first or at the same time.
Yeah, and it was like New York and L.A. blah blah blah, all their yeah. bullshit rules. I just wonder if it's ever going to be something that is going to be representative of what the year put out. Because I mean, you know, there's obviously been good content, mm-hmm. but you know, is something that is the best of what's released going to be what wins the Oscar, you know,
as like opposed to what else?
As opposed to what, you know, I mean, that sounds wrong because that's what it's always supposed to be. But, you know, there is these Oscar movies these Oscar bait movies that come out. So if there's nothing that really, if you can't fill out a category, mm-hmm. like you can't fill out a best actress category, are you going to, you know, with a traditional sort of performance that really drives people, is this going to be the opportunity for smaller things to slip in, or is it going to be something that they put off?
I have to imagine that the Oscars will want to be around because they're just, you know, I think they've been, you know, scrambling for relevancy for the better part of, you know, the last 5 to 10 years.
Right.
And I think that I think that it works. It almost works in their favor too, because if logic serves, all of the movies that are being that are going to be nominated in this hypothetical award show will have there's going to be easy access to, I feel like, and so I think that the films that are nominated for the that year are going to be more accessible than they have been in previous years, and may even feature some stuff that's, you know, made some noise on Netflix or Amazon or Apple TV or whatever. So I think that it actually works in their favor because of name recognition, because there's only so many movies that have come out this year. So, you know, the chances are if people are starved for entertainment, it's going to be easy for them to watch the Oscar movies. And yeah, I don't know. I mean, but what you won't see is that mainstream crossover that the Oscars has been looking for a while, because there are no mainstream movies this year.
Right. I mean, I just wonder, you know, is it going to be something that, you know, you're going to get Julianne Moore and Alicia Vikander nominated for Best Actor, Actress for The Glorias, as opposed to, yeah, you know, I don't know. It's curious to me how this is going to work out, because it's something that has, you know, there's never really been, what am I trying to say?
I don't know.
There's never really been something that's gone so long without, we haven't gone this long without content of any kind. Mm-hmm. And the idea that we're going to be content starved, you know, basically till next year. And I, you know, if there's no reason for, you know, box office on something that is Oscar baity, for example, whatever's in the slate to come out, you know, then I don't know that the studios release it. I don't know that it's something that comes out and you don't just save it for next year.
Well, I mean, I don't know. If there's an Oscar ceremony, then you have a better chance of winning this year than any other, so...
Yeah. Is it going to be the asterisk sort of thing that...
Yeah, I mean... who cares?
I don't, but it's one of those strange things that...
Yeah.
Anyway, anything else before we move on?
No, let's get to it.
All right, let's go ahead and get started on reviews.
Here are this week's reviews.
First up, we have Hubie Halloween.
Well, hello, my ghouls and goblins. I know you've got your costumes picked out for the frightful festivities. And I hope you all get more treats than tricks.
Halloween's upon us!
A good guy. Hubie Dubois is the nicest guy in this town.
Give me some happy Halloween word churches. You can pass it out to the kids.
Thank you so much.
As a trained volunteer, I know what it's like when the spooky fun gets out of hand.
Oh, but you see, the supermarket's selling expired bacon. Janet at the library has not been herself lately.
I heard a voice in the sewer.
I'm sorry, I didn't recognize her.
So this is the latest Adam Sandler film for Netflix. If you want to say that it was the one he threatened for not getting an Oscar nomination for Uncut Gems, I think you probably might be barking up the right tree. But anyway, this is, of course, a Halloween movie. Cody, tell us about Hubie Halloween and what you thought of it.
Well, so I was thinking about this a little bit, and I was wondering how long has it been since I've watched an Adam Sandler comedy, because he recently within the past like 5 years signed this deal with Netflix, where I was like 4 or 5 picture deal that's even been extended from there. And you know, I think both you and I both liked his stand up special quite a bit. Or I did. I don't remember if you did.
Wait, what do you mean the like old stuff? Like
no, the 100% fresh is Netflix stand up special.
Oh, I don't think I watched it.
Oh, really?
I forgot it existed.
Yeah, it's really funny.
Okay. God, I don't know how I missed it, but okay.
I don't know how either, because it was a big deal. But I looked back at it and I had not seen an Adam Sandler comedy since Pixels. Which was terrible. So I haven't seen any of the Netflix stuff, which I've heard is, you know, really, really bad. So I haven't seen like the Grown Ups movies or anything like that. So
you saw That's My Boy though, right?
I did see That's My Boy. I like That's My Boy.
Okay. I do too.
But it's as you can see from that clip, it's all like from the get go, the Adam Sandler accent effect is just it is an unintelligible like take on. I don't even like what is the accent? Like it's a mumble mouth accent.
I mean, it's if you've seen The Waterboy, you know, this is the kind of same thing where it's like, oh, hey, everybody's gonna have this Halloween party, you know, that sort of I mean, it's meant to be mumbly mouthed and weird, I guess, is the I guess it's supposed to be weird.
Yes, and he plays a weirdo who for some reason he's a guy who loves Halloween but is yet scared shitless of every single thing. Like it doesn't make sense why he loves Halloween. And he's, you know, a weirdo who's dry cleaning his piss stained bed sheets and stuff. Like, man, it's rough. And so the movie ends up being like people start disappearing, and then Hubie is sort of takes it into his own hands to solve the disappearances. Meanwhile, he's bullied by every single person in town, except for Julie Bowen, who essentially only exists to be horny for Hubie Halloween, the weirdest guy of all time. Like her character, literally all she ever does is just like fawns over this fucking weirdo. Like beautiful 50-year-old Julie Bowen is super into this guy.
That's the one thing I wanted to say, just about the timeline is, like they're all like class of 1984, mm-hmm. which would make them like all mid-50s, like, which none of those main characters play as a mid-50s.
No.
Someone who's in their mid-50s. Someone who could be a grandmother. Yeah. Anyway. Go ahead.
Yeah, so what it boils down to is this movie is a tough watch. Every single joke that's done is easy, especially there's recurring jokes that happen like that are just run into the ground. Like one of the biggest jokes of the movie is that Hubie has like a Swiss Army thermos, and there's like 50 thermos jokes in this movie. Like it's so exhausting. And then like there's a scene like. There's a running gag where he's biking and then people throw shit at him while he's biking.
I laughed my ass off at that stuff every single fucking time. God damn it.
Oh my God.
Oh, when like someone throws a crutch and like a computer monitor.
I hated that. There's also some self-referential Adam Sandler stuff. I'm just going to spoil it, whatever. The movie opens with the orderly character from Happy Gilmore. It's Ben Stiller. In that part, you know, it's just a really stupid. I think the only time I laughed out loud was Tim Meadows. I think Tim Meadows is really? the only laugh of the movie, wearing like a terrible toupee. like the toupee in that first scene is genuinely very funny, and the fact that he keeps trying to turn Maya Rudolph on, and like the scene where he's sucking his own fingers is pretty funny. Besides that, it's the typical Adam Sandler movie that you would expect, where what it all boils down to is that you should be nice to everyone. Like that's the end result of everything. And look, God bless Adam Sandler for making a career out of making shitty movies with his friends, because that's all this movie really exists to do. And I don't think the cameos are even good. Like I saw a lot of people like this movie. And a lot of people were talking about Steve Buscemi, who I think doesn't even... I don't find Steve Buscemi funny. I didn't find Rob Schneider funny. I don't find Kevin James funny in the movie. To me, it's just a really exhausting, really dumb movie that, you know, the Halloween piece, again, it's a guy who loves Halloween, but is clearly afraid of all of it.
Does it... don't forget that Adam Sandler's kids and his wife are in it again.
Yes, yes, yep.
Yeah, so look, I laughed my ass off a lot at this movie.
Oh my God.
My wife and I watched it together, and there's one particular scene where with Melissa Villaseñor and Hubie rescues her cat from the middle of the road as it's eating a pumpkin from getting run over.
Yeah.
And he throws her the cat and she catches the cat. And then she like mouths off to him, says something. And then Julie Bowen drives up and threatens Melissa Villaseñor, saying that she'll beat her to death with her ugly cat. And then it cuts to like their reaction, like they're mugging to like Melissa Villaseñor mugging to the camera. And there's this terrible like computer generated special effect of the cat mugging to the camera also.
Yeah, I remember.
I laughed my fucking ass off at that. And I did it more often in this movie than I ever expected to. It's stupid as shit. And I think the biggest part of it, though, is it's not. The biggest upside I see to it than the other Adam Sandler movies, which I haven't been a fan of, is it's not lazy.
Really?
Like, I don't think it's lazy. I think
it is entirely lazy.
What do you mean by how do you mean lazy? Because I mean the rest of them, like I'm thinking of stuff like. I mean, this is going
dude. There's like 30 jokes about a thermos. Like,
yeah, but each one of them's funny because
none of them are funny. They fucking suck.
Because it does such stupid different things. I think there's a definite drag. Like you hit the 30-minute mark, and we were laughing a lot, like laughing out loud a lot. There's a 30 minutes to, like 30 minutes in, anything that focuses on Noah Schnapp and the girl, Paris Berlich, I think is her name. I don't know how you pronounce it. You know, anything that doesn't have Hubie directly is kind of dull. And the stuff with these kids, like the characters that Adam Sandler's kids plays, that's not great. But other than that, I thought it was, I mean... It's stupid as shit, and it boils down to the same sort of, like, you should be nice to weirdos
yeah.
mantra that a lot of these Sandler movies do. But God damn it, there is some funny-ass shit in this. And I'm not ashamed to say that I laughed at a lot of it. I mean, the running gag about the thermos, like, being just this incredible multi-tool that has a grappling hook and a vacuum and a telescope. I mean, it's funny.
No,
and it's objectively stupid, but it's stupid in a way that's funny, and it kind of honestly makes me want to go back and rewatch something like The Waterboy, because I remember laughing my ass off at that movie too, and I'm wondering just how stupid it is.
Man, I think you would notice a different level of movie, because I think that every joke in Hubie Halloween is easy. I don't think that there's anything that's hard to come by. I don't think that it's anything other than cheap laughs. Whereas I think The Waterboy and especially Adam Sandler's older stuff is, you know, has some thought put into it. Like it's actually funny. Like again, it's all, you know, Hubie Halloween is mostly sight gags. I mean, it's just lazy. And I'm not even, you know, trying to be above Hubie Halloween. I'm telling you that I only laughed at Tim Meadows, period. That's the only time I ever laughed.
God,
at
I'm just totally the opposite way. I mean, I laughed at a lot of it. I mean, I don't think I laughed, like there is a good stretch in there that's dull, I think. But the Tim Meadows stuff was good. The, I liked the Ray Liotta stuff because it was so mean and strange. When he kicks him into a grave. I think June Sprigg's, like June Sprigg wearing different, like
June Squibb?
Squibb. Sprigg? What did I say?
Spriggs.
Yeah, sorry. Whatever. June Squibb wearing the different, like profane shirts was funny. Shaquille O'Neal, that's a random ass cameo that I thought was funny. Look, I'm not saying it's not stupid. I'm saying that it was fucking funny, and I was downright surprised that it was funny. I don't think it's, you know, it's not a stupid classic like The Waterboy or Happy Gilmore or, you know, even Billy Madison, which it's also references Billy Madison. I'm surprised at how much I laughed at it, and I think that that's... kind of a testament to how terrible Adam Sandler's comedies have gotten, how terrible and lazy they've gotten.
If this hit a high watermark for you.
Well, that I was expecting to be bored and like find it stupid. Like I was expecting this to be more along the lines of The Wrong Missy, which I didn't hate.
I think The Wrong Missy is way funnier than this movie.
See, I don't agree. I don't agree at all. I mean, I love David Spade, and I think David Spade's great at stand-up, but I think that he kind of needs the wacky, like the belligerent person to bounce off of, and I don't think Lauren Lapkus was it. But
I don't know. It made me feel sad to watch Adam Sandler as a 50-something-year-old man doing this kind of bullshit humor. We could not be further on this.
I literally laughed way more than I thought I would, and like genuine, like the fucking joke with the cat. I mean, I rewound it because I wanted to see it again because it was that fucking funny to me. And maybe I'm in a weird spot, you know. I will grant you that maybe this is something that, you know, if I saw it in the theater, I would be annoyed. I don't know. I don't know. I really don't know.
So this is graded on the 2020 trash heap curve.
No, I don't. Well, I don't think so. I don't know. It's really hard to tell because we're so deep into it. But like I liked, what was it? What you're talking about? That's My Boy, I think, was the last Adam Sandler comedy I liked. Pixels is terrible.
Pixels sucks, yeah.
And I don't think I've seen anything comedy-wise after that. I never saw any of the Netflix stuff until this one.
Yeah.
So, anyway, what is your grade for Hubie Halloween, Cody?
Yeah, I think this movie is... I think it's a tough watch. I think it's honestly torturous. It was torturous for me. I give it a D.
Wow. I'm going to give it a B minus, because I had a lot of fun with it, and I laughed a lot. And this is available on Netflix now, so...
I'm just going to throw this in here as a quick comment for my shirt.
Oh, did they win, I guess?
No, but, you know, they came close.
Anyway, okay, let's go ahead and move on to our next movie, Spontaneous.
Hey, mind if I join you guys?
Tess, don't look now, but there's a boy staring at us.
I think he's staring at you.
Oh, right you are. Can't keep me
down. Tell me something, just for me.
First time I saw you was right after Spiros introduced me in front of the class. It was a good first impression.
Caitlin was cute, airy, hardly a reason to pop like a zit.
What happened? Caitlin exploded.
What? Like a bomb?
No, like a balloon.
What?
Will I get these back?
Do you want these back?
And the hell are they gonna let us out of here?
When they know it's not gonna happen again.
Then what's gonna happen again?
It happened again a lot.
This is a comedy slash sort of horror film starring Katherine Langford and Charlie Plummer, who we talked about in... Oh, shit. I just blanked on the title. What is the movie?
Words in Bathroom Walls.
Words on Bathroom Walls. Cody, tell us about Spontaneous and what you thought of it.
Spontaneous is a movie that probably should not be judged by its terrible poster, its its bungled release, or quite honestly, I don't think that trailer does it justice either.
Yeah.
So it's a really dark premise, right? Which is that these high school students are randomly, spontaneously combusting, and it seems to be something that's afflicting only the senior class of this one school. And so you have Katherine Langford's character who gets a text message with a guy who, you know, after seeing that someone had died, decides to take a leap and reach out to her, and he's played by Charlie Plummer. And then they start this relationship as the uncertainty of whether or not they're going to survive starts to kick in. This is a surprisingly great movie. You know, I had heard good things about it, but when you kind of have to watch it because it's a movie that really feels, you know, sometimes with these, I don't know that you would call it young adult movies, but it's sort of like that teen movie.
Yeah. Well, it's from Awesomeness, releasing, which does a lot of this teen movie stuff.
Yeah. And the thing about it that sets it apart is that it feels like it has a very unique voice and a very unique point of view. You know, the dialogue is super snappy and sharp. You know, there's great like references to movies. Like you'll get, like you see like in the movie, like an E.T. reference or a great E.T. reference. There's also a reference to, oh God, I can't remember. There's another reference in there. So you have Catherine Langford, who, you know, her character's really sarcastic and, you know, half of the story is about the love story that's you know, blossoming between Langford and Plummer. And then the second half of what you see is something like surprisingly meditative that kind of catches you off guard a little bit. I think performance-wise, you know, we talked about Plummer and Words on Bathroom Walls, who was great in that movie. He's great in this movie as well. Really enjoying watching him, you know, sort of take on these roles that are, you know, he's taken on a couple of like roles that could have been really generic in someone else's hands. And I think he's playing them really well. I think that it's Catherine Langford's movie though. And, she's really great. Like I said, really great at delivering these comedic lines, really darkly comedic stuff. Good sense of humor. And plays it with a lot of, you know, a lot of, like showing of acting chops that I think she's going to impress a lot of people. The spontaneous combustion story is also pretty well done too, especially, you know, again, the darkness of, you know, like teenage kids exploding into, you know, giant, you know, puddles of blood. It's gruesome and it's dark and I really appreciate that element of it, that it doesn't really shy away from, you know, some dark stuff.
And I assume it's some sort of allegory to kind of angst and and there's a subplot about a pill that's developed to prevent this, but you never really know if it's going to work. Mm-hmm. Which I took it to be like a sort of antidepressant.
I think that could be there. I think that the, you know, I saw some, you know, a lot of places say that it gets repetitive. And I think that is the case, but also there's a scene in the movie where the explosions sort of pick up a little bit. And that was a scene that was like shockingly effective for me, because it sort of ensues like a lot of chaos ensues, if you know what scene I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. And I think it's really well executed, because a movie like this with such a ridiculous premise could really kind of, go off the rails a little bit, I think, in terms of like the lack of believability or the suspension of disbelief. And I think it handles it really well, and it feels really authentic, and the stakes feel real throughout. And then, like I said, the second half of the movie gets into some really, like, again, surprisingly, I would say, like I said, meditative. It's surprisingly, you know, ask some real big questions about life in general. You know, it's impressive. I mean, I think, you know, a lot of credit goes to the script for being really strong. And I, you know, I told you this earlier, but, it's one of those movies where, you know, this movie was hard to come by a little bit. You know, yeah. we had to rent it, and it was not easy even as, you know, press folks to get a hold of it. And this is the type of movie where it would, if it were put on Netflix, people would be talking about it for weeks. It would be the big movie of the of you know, a span of a couple weeks. You know, this sort of like romantic comedy ish, but also dark and kind of weird movie would have a really good life on Netflix. And it's just such a shame that more people will not see this movie, because it's really, really good.
Well, yeah, and you know, Netflix has kind of made a niche of these teen rom-coms.
Yeah.
For better or worse, in that sort of, you know, genre thing. But, I mean, look, this is one of the best movies of the year that we've seen. I mean, that I've seen, particularly. It's, you know, it does have that sort of faint teen movie, what would you call it? You know, you said young adult, and I that's kind of what I mean, but, like, there's really swelling music. Like really swelling alt rock soundtrack, and then there is kind of the let's call it the Fault in Our Stars formula.
Sure.
Where, you know, you kind of get the idea that something terrible is going to happen without giving anything away. And I think that's maybe its only flaw, but I that may not even be a flaw in that that's just how the story is told. It's based on a novel, which, you know, is a pretty standard young adult trope. But just the performances alone, you know, Charlie Plummer's great. Catherine Langford, this is like if this were a bigger movie, this would be a huge star-making performance, yeah. I think. You know, this is something that, you know, this character is 100% unique, has an amazing lived-in voice that is really hard to come by in these teen movies, and is genuinely affected by the events that happen, and, you know, has real conversations. It is not like, you know, there's no one there to save her.
Yeah.
You know, which is kind of what these things always boil down to. There's a great, great scene. I'm not going to spoil any more details other than it takes place between her and an older woman.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That sort of sealed the movie for me.
I think. I mean, that scene is so good.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, that the idea that this is a, you know, a teen movie about, you know, seniors in high school blowing, spontaneously combusting. I mean, it's bloody as hell. But it's, you know, it the reactions to it, I think, are genuine. You know, it's not really, you know, I hinted that it's a horror movie, and I think that's kind of what it's being sold at a little bit, but it's not really. It's just more of like a fantastical realism thing that,
yeah,
you know, this thing is happening and people don't know why, and it's only targeting these teenagers for whatever particular reason. I mean, it's just, it was so surprisingly good. Mm-hmm. And I like you said, I wish it were on Netflix so it could be something that,
yeah,
gets talked about.
And I think one thing we have, it's really funny too.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
There's a lot of like really great jokes in here, and like even something that, like there's a your mom joke in here that's really funny, and then a follow up to it that, you know, stuff like that that just feels, again, it feels lived in, it feels authentic, like it feels like you know, these teen movies can go either way with like the authenticity where it feels like it's actual teenage people, like that voice, and this movie captured like the teenage voice, I think, better than most do.
Right, like a lot of them have that sort of like epic, we're going on a journey of self-discovery kind of mindset that no teen really has. Mm-hmm. I don't think the kind of movies I talk about where like it just needs like some older brother character to be like, stop doing being fucking stupid.
Yeah,
but you know, this one has such a strange premise and the way everyone's navigating it.
And I was quiet. So the very last scene, I think, is really great, and it features a great Trump joke in it. But the last like 15 minutes of the movie, I was, you know, including the scene that you're talking about, it is shockingly existential in a way that, yeah, that is profound. I mean, quite honestly, it, you know, the leaving and lasting message of the film is way more profound than you would expect from a movie like this. If just on the surface, based on the trailer, based on, you know, the poster, the subject matter, everything.
Yeah. I mean, it looks like a shitty teen rom-com. Mm-hmm. And it's so far from that. And it's, yeah. There's a great funny joke that I just remembered of like a flashback between Catherine Langford's character and her best friend at the very beginning when they're in a diner. Mm-hmm. That was just randomly weird and funny. It's really, really good. And I was, again, like Hubie Halloween, but in a better way. I was very surprised by how good this was.
Yeah.
What's your grade, Cody?
Well, I think, again, I think it's very good. I don't know that it's it's probably in the top maybe 10 to 15 movies I've seen this year. I think that it does occasionally get a little bit repetitive. And I think that there's a small stretch in the movie where they're like contained in a bubble, that I think may like wears a little bit thin. That aside, again, I'm very surprised. I really enjoyed it, and I'm giving it a B+.
Yeah, I still think it's one of the best movies I've seen this year, and I think it's funny and it's genuine, and there's no, I don't think it hits any kind of false notes at all. So I'm going to give it an A minus. So it is available VOD, right?
Yeah, yeah. I think you can rent only it for VOD? Like $10 or something like that. Yeah. If you're looking for something to watch, if you haven't been renting movies or anything, like throw $10 to this movie. I think
this is definitely worth it.
Yeah.
All right, let's move on to our next movie, The Wolf of Snow Hollow.
We have every reason to believe that this monster will show up again tonight.
John, I'm an alcoholic. I've been in the program now for 6 years. Sober for 3.
This is scary. It's new. I never saw a body like that.
There's gonna be a lot of late nights and overtime because of the brutal murder that happened in town, and I didn't want to set up expectations that I can't keep.
Our expectations of you are very low.
Spans of the bites are gigantic, same as the distance of the paw prints.
It's a wolf, or maybe it's a werewolf. No, let me just make this perfectly clear. There is no such thing as werewolves. Our killer is a guy, and I'm gonna find him, and I'm gonna kill... And we're gonna bring him to justice.
We have every reason to believe that this monster will show up again tonight. I won't ask you to pray with me, because of the goddamn lawyers.
Where were you? Where were you?
John!
None of you talked to me once, okay? There's seven...
So this is the latest film from writer-director Jim Cummings, who also stars. He was in a film a few years ago called Thunder Road. Cody, tell us about The Wolf of Snow Hollow and what you thought of it.
So the last time we interacted with a Jim Cummings movie was Thunder Road, a movie that, you know, had a ton of buzz around it. And a movie that I think both of us were a bit flummoxed by the reaction to. I thought Thunder Road was a fine movie, but it's a movie that I felt like Cummings wrote for himself as an actor that just featured like 20 giant monologues.
Wasn't it an expanded short?
It was an expanded short. And so the short, if you remember that movie, it opens with an extended monologue of him breaking down at a funeral.
Mm-hmm.
That was all the short film was, which was great in a vacuum, because I think it's, you know, it was just one long monologue where he sort of unravels. And then the rest of the movie, weirdly enough, he played a cop in that movie too. Just sort of repeated the same thing over again. And it was just basically Jim Cummings, unraveling for an hour and a half, which, surprise, surprise, is what Wolf of Snow Hollow is. A bit confused by the movie, as it's not quite horror, and it's also not quite comedy. It's this weird tweener that that never quite settles into a tone for me. I don't think that the humor works particularly well. I'm just not really a fan of Jim Cummings' humor. And then it sort of becomes an investigation on this wolf that seems to be hunting people down, and In the way that it's just, again, a 75-minute character study of a guy who's unraveling. And it's unfortunate because I think Jim Cummings could be a really talented actor in the right capacity, but the way that he writes his scripts are that he kind of sets himself up for these, like, coming undone moments. And they just, that's it. That's all there's there. It's one thing. It's one speed. And so it really keeps the movie from going anywhere. And I think that the script is overwritten. There's too many shoehorned jokes in there that I don't think are effective. Like I said, I think the plot is pretty generic overall. And I just don't think it has much to say. I mean, I think that it's just another platform for these Jim Cummings meltdown moments, because that's, you know, it doesn't start that way, but once you get to the point where he starts breaking down, all the movie really sort of, you know, becomes is is that people are putting a lot of pressure on the police and Jim Cummings is not handling it well. And that's really the movie.
Yeah, I don't really understand the... it's called a comedy. And Thunder Road was also called like a comedy drama. And I just don't see it. I don't get the funny... Like, there are funny bits. Like the clip with Robert Forster talking about the lawyers. I mean, that's a joke, ostensibly. But it's not... Like, nothing about this screams comedy to me, and it just feels like the same thing over again. Every time Jim Cummings... Like, this feels like Thunder Road again, only with a potential werewolf. It just... Like, I don't understand what the point of him being the guy breaking down is as it relates to this story, because he's hunting down a murderer while trying to insulate his dad, Robert Forster, who's the sheriff. By the way, one of the things that bugs me the most is when they call each other officer, mm-hmm. but they're deputies. Like, just get it fucking straight. They're sheriff's deputies. Anyway, Robert Forster in his last film role, I don't know. It sort of feels like it. Did he die while this was in production? Because it feels like his part is really truncated.
I don't know, but what I did notice was I think that they must have built something into the character, because almost in almost every scene he's being held up by people. You know,
yeah.
It seemed like he was not in a great place making.
Yeah, and his character kind of takes a, his character, if you. Can kind of telegraph his fate from the beginning of the film. His character does kind of disappear rather abruptly. And it's supposed to be like a plot point in the film, but it just never really feels earned. Nothing ever feels... And there's like some strange playing with timelines of in montages that I don't really think were... Bottom line, it's just Jim Cummings melting down is what this is all supposed to be. And it just feels like exactly the same thing as we saw before. And I think it doesn't really add anything to the story to have him melting down. Like, I don't get what's happening. Like, I don't get how these two things are connected other than it's the plot. Just kind of like, and it is getting high praise again. I just feel it was just so disappointing to me.
Yeah, it's just one note, and I think it's just it. Like I said, I don't think it ever settles into a tone. I don't think the tone is ever consistent, and I think that the jokes just don't land. I mean, I just don't think that they're funny. Maybe that's a personal preference. Maybe that's, I don't know, but I think it really fails. And if it wants to be like a horror comedy, the comedy piece is not quite there. And also the horror piece is not quite there. So it just, like I said, it's a weird in-between movie that I feel just struggles to ever get going.
Honestly. And then by the time it's resolved, it doesn't really make any sense. Yeah, anyway, what's your grade for The Wolf of Snow Hollow?
I'm giving it a C. I don't think that it's like a terribly made movie. It's not for me.
Yeah, I'm going to give it a C also. I just feel like it's something that I don't get what the fuss is about with Jim Cummings, if it's going to keep being the same exact thing over and over and over again. But this is... is this on VOD and theaters also?
This is on... Yes, yep.
Okay. All right, let's go ahead and move on to our last movie, Yellow Rose.
I never fit in, never could win.
This isn't the life you wanted.
Though I tried and tried.
It'll be better for you.
This feeling don't end.
I promise.
Swear.
I fell in love with country music when I was a little girl.
When are you gonna let me hear you play?
If you're too scared to perform them songs,
I'll run away.
Ain't gonna do no good.
With nowhere to go.
I received another letter.
Immigration and Customs Enforcement! We have a warrant to search!
Does anyone else here reside with you? Is there anyone who lives here?
No.
No one resides with you?
No.
No other residents?
Ah!
Hey!
Ah!
Hey!
Stop! Where are they taking you?
This is a film set in and shot in the Austin, Texas area, featuring real life country singer, country sort of rockabilly singer, Dale Watson, who's not in the clip, but plays a pretty big part in the film. Cody, tell us about Yellow Rose and what you thought of it.
Yeah, I didn't know much about Yellow Rose coming into it, other than I knew that it had some sort of Austin connection. So I was pretty surprised to find out that like the whole thing is in the Austin area, Austin and Bastrop. And I don't, I assume those are actual places in Bastrop.
The Bastrop, yeah, that hotel that's a real motel, yeah.
Okay, yeah. And it reminded me a lot of a movie called Wild Rose that came out last year, mm-hmm. A Jesse Buckley movie, where it was sort of an Irish girl who wanted to move to Nashville to become a country singer, but it was like really, you know, it was not really about that. It was a character study, and so this movie is an immigration story more than anything else. So it's a you know, it's a character, a young girl who's her mother and her father who had passed away are immigrants from the Philippines, but they are undocumented, and so her mother ends up getting picked up in an ICE raid, and so she kind of escapes and tries to find her footing and find somewhere to live. Because to avoid going to foster care, I gotta look up her name. So the main actress in the film is actually a Broadway actress.
Oh, yeah.
She was in Miss Saigon. Her name is Eva Noblezada. Mm-hmm. I think that she is very, very good in the movie. I think it's a really good performance. I actually think the acting, you know, these Texas movies sometimes have these local Austin actors, I suspect in a lot of cases, that really kind of, you know, it's funny because you can tell a Texas movie because it's always like, it's always filled with characters that are just kind of off in terms of feeling like actual actors. Like you can tell that they're not quite real people, but they're also not like Hollywood actors. And it's a quality I really like the people that populate Boyhood, you know, it's a bunch of like,
sure,
like characters, you know? And I think for his part, Dale Watson is actually pretty good in the movie. I think it's a good performance. And so, you know, the movie becomes, essentially about, you know, dueling stories of an immigration story and a story about a girl who's, you know, attracted to country music, who is really talented. And I think it's a solid movie. I think that the immigration story feels really authentic in terms of, you know, more or less things that are happening to a lot of people and the sort of fear that undocumented people have to go through of, not being able to stay in the country where they are, especially when they have kids who they're trying to give a better life to. And I think that those pieces work well. I think that the relationship with the mother is maybe the one part that doesn't work quite as well, because I think the mother is that story feels a little bit disjointed at times, because it's really about, you know, the girl. It's really about her character and her journey. I think that at times I think it goes down like the corny route a little bit, though I don't think that it necessarily, I think it kind of toes the line with a good enough balance for me. I think that the music part is really interesting too. I think the music in it is good. I like the music storyline, and I like the connection that her and Dale Watson have with music and like the idea of, you know, having catharsis through writing music and performing music. And yeah, I mean, I just think it's a really solid, if at times a little bit forced movie, but I found myself enjoying most of it.
So I feel like the immigration stuff is pretty front and center, and I think that takes up a lot of the film, and I think it's obviously very prescient. I think there's a little bit of kind of convenience in some of the stuff. There's a second ICE raid in the movie that we saw a little bit of in the clip that I think goes very unrealistically. By the way, it's resolved for the character, the main character of, what is her name? Rose. Duh. Mm. Sorry. So that was, oh, man, it's been a long day. The idea, though, that so her mother is detained by ICE, and you know, I think the movie does a great job of portraying the awful situation of it, the reality of being just assigned a number as opposed to your name, and the dehumanization of it all. Though I don't think that any character really gets to have a good arc, because I think it's spread too thin. Like, so after she's detained and taken into custody, those are the same thing, but after she's taken into custody and put in a detention center, she tells Rose to go visit, to go find her aunt, played by Lea Salonga, who of course is, you know, kind of a Broadway legend, and you know, did singing voices for Disney movies. That doesn't really go anywhere. It just is like a pit stop along the way.
Yeah, I mean, I think we had some separate conversations about this, and I really think that there's a lot that happens in this movie that is meant to push the narrative forward or reinforce some narrative points. You know, so I think that a lot of those things are just kind of showing that Rose is sort of out of place. You know, I think the character quality that happens with Rose throughout most of the movie is that when she starts sensing that she's not wanted, she runs away in some way. And that, I think, is the first kind of establishment of that character trait.
Yeah, but you know, the thing is, like, she's an immigrant, right? But she's very clearly of a different generation than her mother.
Yeah.
You know, she's very clearly an American child, whether or not she's a citizen. And I don't think the movie really explores that enough. You know, the nearest it gets to her being kind of not welcome, so to speak, in the country music scene is her telling the story to Dale Watson is that people called her Yellow Rose, which is obviously, you know, a racist term, regarding her heritage. Other than that, I don't really think it really explains why she is so much of an outcast, especially, look, the movie says she's never been to Austin. If she lives in Bastrop, that's fucking ridiculous, which is plot wise, that's stupid. But, you know, the fact that she's in the suburb of a very accepting, you know, metropolitan area, I think is something the movie kind of, you know, willfully ignores. You know, everyone knows Austin is the different city in Texas. You know, if this were set like somewhere in the middle of West Texas or East Texas or something, then I could understand that. I just feel like it doesn't ever portray her as someone who's struggling with, like, because she's clearly extremely talented. And, you know, all she, you know, she would, you know, obviously she's the character is shy and she has to kind of find her voice. But, you know, the idea that she's sort of an outcast in this country music genre is never really portrayed, I don't believe. And, you know, the problem
Go ahead. Well, I was just going to say, I see what you're saying, but I also don't think that that's a story that they ever, like, that's ever hinted towards, but not explored. I just think that I don't think the outcast nature of it is part of the narrative.
Well, the song she sings is literally about being a square peg in a round hole. I mean, that's kind of the thesis of the movie.
Right, but I took that more of like, not necessarily in country music. I thought that was just more of a, I don't know, maybe.
But see, and if you try to apply it to the immigration stuff, like, yeah, obviously, you know, she's, you know, facing down this very real fear of ICE showing up. But like I said, she's of a different generation than her mother. Like, she is not, she doesn't remember the Philippines. She's an American child.
Yeah, but she's also never treated as an outcast. And also her connection to country music is never seen as weird or strange. I mean,
but I feel like the movie tries to make that point.
I don't feel like that.
I think the character that Lea Salonga plays doesn't really add anything to the film. And I think, you know, it gets a little hokey with the bar owner letting her live there in the bar, which, you know, and then her finally getting onto Dale Watson. I think the Dale Watson character has the potential to be something that is really kind of profound. Like it reminded me a little bit, like the way I think it should have gone was the relationship in Bull. You remember Bull?
Mm-hmm.
With the sort of reluctant person taking him over. Because like in the film, Dale Watson's just a goddamn nice guy. You know, it's hinted at that he's had these demons, like he was barely fathers to his own kids. But that never is really borne out. You know, he's just a nice old man, country singer, who takes in this girl, you know, kind of sight unseen. And I feel like there's a complexity there that's missing. And I just feel like that's kind of the whole thing. Like the movie hints at a more complex problem for the character of Rose and never really delivers on it.
Well, and I think that the difference is, I don't disagree with what you're saying. I also think that, you know, if we're talking about the aunt storyline, I think that there's a lot of hinted but untapped stuff with her aunt's husband as well. Like being like a closet racist or something, like there's something like strange about that relationship that's either like controlling or abusive, even, that they hint towards but never go down. The difference is that I think that those are things that could have made a good movie better, because I think overall I think it's a solid watch, and I was watching it and I was, you know, I think that the story beats that it hits are good. I think that the performances are good. I like when these sort of music movies come out and they feel authentic and real. And so for me, you know, I don't think that what you're saying is invalid, but I also think that it's a good movie that could have been great with some of these changes.
See, I think it's a sloppy movie that could have been better. I think that there's too many, there's not enough character motivation. There's not enough kind of background into, you know, who Rose is, other than that her mom is, you know, that she's an immigrant from the Philippines and her mother was deported or is threatening to be deported. I don't know. What's your grade, Cody?
Like I said, I think that it could be better. I don't agree that it's sloppy, because I think it's a well-made movie. And I think that there's just areas where you're like, okay, well, maybe they could have done this instead of this, and it would have accentuated it. It would have made it even better. So that being said, it does have flaws. So I'm going to give it a solid B.
Yeah, I was waffling between a C plus and a B minus. I think I'm going to give it a B minus, because I do like Eva Noble-Zeta very, very much. I think she's incredibly talented and you know, is, I think, in her mid-20s, but looks like she's 15 or however.
Yeah, she's got the Taylor Russell affliction.
Yeah, yeah. And I think that I liked Dale Watson in it. You know, he's kind of a cartoon character of a person anyway.
Yeah.
I don't know if you're familiar with him before this, but
a little bit.
You know, it's that kind of cartoon rockabilly thing that's happening. And I think he does well with what he's got. I think that character could have been much deeper. So I'm going to give it a B minus.
Fair.
Yeah. That's going to do it for this week. Next week, what do we got, Cody?
So next week we have potentially a great week, because three of the movies coming out have like rave reviews, like best of the year type quality. Mm-hmm. So first off, we have the new Aaron Sorkin movie, Trial of the Chicago 7.
Mm-hmm. Seen a lot of good reviews for that.
Yeah, you know, it's only Sorkin's second movie that he's directed, and I really liked his first one, Molly's Game.
I did too. It's a little overwritten in that I don't think real people would quote The Crucible to one another.
But Aaron Sorkin is overwritten.
No, it is. I mean, it is Aaron Sorkin. I get it.
I think both of us are people who think that there's a good Sorkin and a bad Sorkin, and finding that line is sometimes a challenge. But
Molly's Game was really good. I really did like Molly's Game.
Yeah. We also have a documentary called Time that's being released on Amazon that is supposed to be great. One that I'm really excited about, I don't know how you're going to feel about it, kind of wish Jocelyn would be back for this one, because it's up her alley too, is David Byrne's American Utopia. the documentary based on the Broadway show from David Byrne from Talking Heads, directed by Spike Lee, getting rave reviews from its release at festivals and just the show in general. It's a show that's played all around.
Is it about the Talking Heads?
No, it's a live performance.
It's
a performance of a show that he toured for a long time and then was on Broadway with. And then Spike Lee filmed the performance and directed the performance.
Wait, so it's a musical performance?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. It's a concert, basically.
Gotcha.
And
is he going to wear the big suit? That's all I want to know.
He's not going to wear the big suit from Stop Making Sense. No.
Son of a bitch.
But it's like a cool setup where it's like him and like a 12-piece band and they're all wearing the same clothes and all of their instruments are wireless. So everyone that's playing a instrument on stage is like moving around the whole time. It's apparently an incredible show. So I'm really excited about it. And then for the fourth movie, I think we might do a movie with a great title that I saw at South by Southwest that didn't happen called Shit House. A movie that I would be interested in revisiting because it's one of those movies that like the director of it, his name is Cooper Rafe. He's like 23. It's an interesting thing because it feels like, yeah, he's 23. It feels like a guy who's making his first movie who you can feel like at someday, some point is going to be great, but like is not quite there yet. So maybe Shit House, maybe something else. I don't know.
All right. Well, if you want to reach us, you can email us at podcast@cinesnob.net. Find us on Twitter @cinesnob, Facebook CineSnob Critic. Listen to our other shows, ReMCU, rewatching the Marvel Cinematic Universe, which I'm sorry I didn't get to watch anything this week, Cody, so we didn't get to record anything. It's been a busy week, god damn it. And then what's the other one? Oh yeah, Quarantine Stream, which we're hopefully recording a new episode soon. With another guest that is new to us. Cody, you have the Ramble.
Yeah, Ramble Radio Tuesdays and Fridays. Ramble, the regular Ramble on Wednesdays, and then Good Willow Hunting on Thursdays. This week will be Full Metal Jacket is this week. And then in the subsequent weeks, we're doing, I'll let you watch Good Willow Hunting and figure that out.
Oh, look at you teasing. You can also find my work on The Hard Times. I've got another article in the hopper ready to come out. A lot of fun times going on here in the world going to shit. So anything else before we go, Cody?
No, I don't think so. I'm excited for the rest of October. I think looking even beyond the week after, there's some stuff that, I'm really looking forward to. We've got the Borat sequel coming up in a couple of weeks.
Oh yeah. I'm really looking forward to that.
It's crazy that, you know, we're going on, I don't know how many weeks, not in a row cause we took a week off, but this is the most productive we've been since we started this show. And It's interesting. I'm watching a lot more movies than I have in a long time.
Yeah, you know, I think I've talked about it before, but going to the theater is a chore sometimes. Mm-hmm. And I know that sounds stupid, but being able to watch everything at home is great.
Yeah, I mean, it's so much easier to just say I can pop in a fourth movie because if I was going to the theater, it would be, you know, for you, sitting in traffic, you know, plus the movie plus whatever is you know, you could watch two movies in that span.
I mean, to get across Austin sometimes it was like an hour just to get there. It's like Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Anyway. All right. Okay, on that note, I'm Jerrod Kingery.
I'm Cody Viafania.
Thank you for listening to the CineSnob podcast. To read reviews, interviews, and more, visit cinesnob.net. See you next week.